बिस्मिल्लाहिर्रहमानिर्रहीम। डियर स्टूडेंट्स, द टॉपिक ऑफ आवर टुडेज डिस्कशन इज सॉइल ट्रांसमिटेड हेमिथियासिस। लर्निंग ऑब्जेक्टिव्स ऑफ टुडेज लेक्चर इंक्लूड प्रॉब्लम स्टेटमेंट, देन वी विल डिस्कस द एपिडेमियोलॉजिकल डिटर्मिनर्स एंड देन क्लिनिकल फीचर्स एंड डायग्नोसिस ऑफ द डिजीज एंड फाइनली preventive and control measures. Soil transmitted helminth infections, they refer to a group of parasitic diseases in humans which are caused by intestinal roundworms, also known as ascariasis. Hookworms, these include Necator americanus and Ancylostoma duodenale, and whipworm, known as Trichiurus trichiura. These are the most common infections worldwide, as more than 1.5 billion people, or about 2.24% of the world population, is infected with them. Infections, they are widely distributed, with the greatest numbers of disease occurring in sub-Saharan Africa, Americas, China, and the East Asia. Now we will discuss the mode of transmission. Soil transmitted helminths, they are transmitted by eggs that are passed in the feces of infected people. As adult worms, they live in the intestine where they produce thousands of eggs each day. In areas that lack adequate sanitation, these eggs, they contaminate the soil, and this contamination can happen in several ways, which include eggs that are attached to vegetables and salads, they are ingested. Number two, eggs are ingested from contaminated water sources. And number three, eggs are ingested by children who are playing in the soil. The hookworm eggs, they hatch in the soil, releasing the larvae that mature into a form that can actively penetrate the skin. People become infected with hookworm primarily by walking barefoot on a contaminated soil. After discussing the mode of transmission, now we will discuss each of the soil transmitted helminthiasis infection in detail. First of all, we will discuss the roundworm infection, that is ascariasis. It is basically an infection of the intestinal tract caused by the adult Ascaris lumbricoides, and it is clinically manifested by vague symptoms of nausea, abdominal pain, and cough. Live worms, they are passed in the stool or vomited. Occasionally, they may produce intestinal obstruction, or they may migrate into the peritoneal cavity. Ascariasis is the most common helminthic infestation. It is estimated that about 1 billion people of 1 billion people are infected worldwide annually, with about 12 million acute cases and 20,000 or more deaths. Heavy infection of this worm is common in children aged 3 to 8 years. Now we will discuss the epidemiological determinants of the disease. First of all, we will discuss agent factors. Agent is Ascaris lumbricoides. It lives in the lumen of small intestine where it moves freely. The eggs, they are excreted in the feces. Reservoir of infection. Man is the only reservoir. Infective material. Feces containing the fertilized eggs, they are the infective material. Now we will discuss the host factors. Infection rates, they are high in children. They are the most important. And children, they are the most important disseminators of infection. There is a high degree of host parasite tolerance. Roundworms, they rob man of his food and may possibly compete for vitamin A in the intestine. Roundworms, they contribute to malnutrition, especially in children who may show growth retardation. Now we will discuss the environmental factors. The eggs of roundworms, they remain viable in the soil for months or years under favorable conditions. Temperature, moisture, oxygen pressure, and ultraviolet radiation from sunlight, they affect the population of Ascaris eggs. A low temperature inhibits the development of eggs. Clay soil, they are the most favorable for the development of Ascariasis eggs. Human habits also play an important role. Seeding of the soil by Ascariasis eggs takes place by the human habit of indiscriminate open air defecation. It is the most important factor which is responsible for the widespread distribution of the Ascariasis in the world. Children playing in the contaminated soil, they contaminate their hands and foot and thus get the infection. Period of communicability. Until all fertile females are destroyed and stools are negative. The incubation period of disease varies from 18 days to several weeks. Symptoms. People with light infection, they usually have no symptoms. However, the heavier infections can cause a range of symptoms including intestinal manifestations like diarrhea, abdominal pain, general malaise, weakness, impaired cognition, and physical development. The larvae migration may cause fever, cough, sputum formation, asthma, skin rash, and eosinophilia. Adult roundworms aggregate masses can cause volvulus, intestinal obstruction, or intussusception. Dear students, now we will discuss the hookworm infections. Hookworm infection is defined as any infection caused by Ancylostoma duodenale or Nicator americanus. Hookworm infection may occur as single or mixed infections in the same person. First of all, we will discuss the problem statement. Ancylostoma duodenale and Nicator americanus, they are the main nematodes causing the hookworm infection in man. Hookworm infection is seen in the warm, moist climates in Asia, Africa, Central and South America, and the South Pacific region. Ancylostoma duodenale infection is more prevalent in Europe and Southwestern Asia, while the Nicator americanus infection is more common in tropical Africa and in the Americas. It is estimated that during 2012, the global prevalence of hookworm was about 576 million to 740 million cases. Of these, about 80 million were severely affected. Dear students, now we will discuss the epidemiological determinants. First of all, we will discuss the agent factors. Agent. Adult worms, they live in the small intestine. Eggs are passed in the feces in thousands, and when these eggs, they are deposited on warm, moist soil, a larva rapidly develops in the eggs and pierces the skin of the human host, feet skin. Larvae of Ancylostoma duodenale, they are also infected by mouth. Reservoir. Man is the only important reservoir of human hookworm infection. Infective material is basically the feces. Feces containing the ova of the hookworms, they are the infective material. However, the immediate source of infection is the soil, which is contaminated with infective larvae. Period of communicability is as long as the person is harboring that parasite. Dear students, now we will discuss the host factors. Age and sex. All ages and both sexes, they are susceptible to infection. Nutrition. Malnutrition is a predisposing factor. The chronic disabling disease does not occur in the otherwise healthy individual. Host parasite balance. In endemic areas, the inhabitants, they develop a host parasite balance in which the worm load is limited. In some areas, the infection rate may be nearly 100%. This delicate balance may be upset by malnutrition. Occupation. Hookworm infection, they have a high prevalence in agricultural than in the town workers. And in many tropical countries, hookworm infection is an occupational disease of the farming community. Now we will discuss the environmental factors. Soil. The type of soil that favors the survival of the hookworm larvae is a damp, sandy soil with decaying vegetation. Temperature. A temperature of 24 to 32 centigrade is considered favorable for the survival of the larvae. Oxygen. This is required for the growth and development of the larvae, and moisture is necessary for survival. Dryness is rapidly fatal. Rainfall. A rainfall of 40 inches and above is considered a favorable environmental factor. Shade. Direct sunlight kills the larvae, whereas shade protects them. Human habits. They are important factors. Human habits include indiscriminate defecation, using the same places for defecation, going barefoot, farming practices using untreated sewage, children wading in the infected mud with bare feet and hands. These habits, they are compounded by social factors such as illiteracy, ignorance, and low standards of living. Now we will discuss the incubation period. Following infection, period for Necator americanus is 7 weeks, while that for Ancylostoma duodenale is unpredictable, ranging from 5 weeks to 9 months. This is because the invading larva of the Ancylostoma duodenale is capable of remaining arrested or dormant in the tissues of the host for as long as 9 months, and then again resume development and migration. Effects of the disease on individual. Hookworm infection causes chronic blood loss and leads to iron deficiency anemia. This has implications for child health in terms of retarded physical growth and development, for the health of the mothers in terms of increased morbidity, low birth weight babies, abortion, stillbirths, and impaired lactation, and for the health of individuals in terms of diminished capacity for sustained hard work. The effects on community. Hookworm infection exerts a significant harmful effect on nutrition, growth and development, work and productivity, and medical care costs. Now we will discuss the whipworm infection. Whipworm is the third most common soil transmitted helminthiasis in the humans. According to current estimate, nearly 800 million people they are infected, and majority of the cases they are children in the age range of 4 to 10 years. Heavy infections could lead to acute symptoms such as diarrhea and anemia, and chronic symptoms such as growth retardation and impaired cognitive development. Whipworm infection is quite common in United States, Southeast Asia, Africa, Central and South Americas. Agent factors. Whipworms, they live in the large intestine, It can withstand cold temperatures. The infection is directly from the feces. Eggs hatch after being swallowed in the intestine, where shell is digested by intestinal juices and the larva emerges in the small intestine. Incubation period. It is the period from the ingestion of eggs to the appearance of eggs in stools, and this is about 60 to 90 days. Effects of the disease. Majority of the infections, they are mild or asymptomatic. It causes epigastric pain, nausea, vomiting, distension, flatulence, weight loss. Moderate infections cause growth deficit and anemia, while the severe infections, they cause severe chronic diarrhea or dysentery with blood and mucus in stools, dehydration, rectal prolapse, colonic obstruction, hypoproteinemia, chronic iron deficiency anemia, etc. Now we will discuss the prevention and control of soil transmitted helminths. First, we will discuss the primary prevention. Primary preventive measures include centered disposal of human excreta to prevent or reduce the fecal contamination of the soil, provision of safe drinking water, food hygienic habits, health education of the community in the use of sanitary latrines, personal hygiene, and changing the behavioral patterns, and the measures of personal protection such as wearing protective footwear and making use of health facilities for diagnosis and treatment. In secondary prevention, effective drugs are piperazine, mebendazole, levamisole, and parenteral albendazole. The usual dose for adults and children over 2 years of age is 400 mg as a single dose, contraindicated in children below 2 years and also in pregnancy. Mebendazole, the usual dose is 100 mg twice daily for 3 days for all ages above 2 years. Levamisole, a single oral dose of 2.5 mg per kg of body weight, it has been recommended. Maximum dose is 150 mg. It has been successfully used in the mass treatment of ascariasis. Parenteral, it is effective in a single dose of 10 mg per kg of body weight with a maximum of 1 gram. Treatment of anemia and other complications should be promptly done. Anemia should be treated with iron and folic acid, and patients should be treated for hypoproteinemia and hypereosinophilia. Preventive chemotherapy. World Health Organization strategy for control of soil transmitted helminth infection is to control morbidity through periodic treatment of at-risk people living in endemic areas. The people at risk are preschool-aged children, school-aged children, women of childbearing age, including pregnant women in second and third trimesters, and breastfeeding women, mothers, and adults in certain high-risk occupations such as tea pickers or miners. WHO recommends periodic deworming without previous individual diagnosis to all at-risk people living in endemic areas. Treatment should be given once a year when prevalence of soil-transmitted helminth infection in the community is over 20%, and twice a year if the prevalence is over 50%. Schools provide a particularly good entry point for deworming activities, as they allow easy provision of health and hygiene education component such as promotion of hand washing and improved sanitation. The recommended medicines are albendazole and mebendazole. They are effective and can be easily administered by non-medical persons. These drugs are donated by WHO. The global target is to eliminate morbidity due to soil-transmitted helminthiasis in children by the year 2020. This will be achieved by regularly treating at least 75% of the children in endemic areas, that is an estimated 873 million children. This concludes our today's lecture. Thank you very much.